welcome you to our next version of the town hall. This will be a civilian-focused event. Really, the reason we're here is to make sure that we entertain and really focus in on the conversations and discussions and concerns that have been asked from our audience writ large. And the intent here is to cover the civilian populace, which includes GS, NAF, LNDH, MOD, and contractors. And to my right is Colonel William Deadeye Marshall, and I'd like to offer him the microphone at this time.
Excellent. Thank you, Colonel Pannon. I'd just like to say, first and foremost, thanks, Colonel Pannon, and the team for hosting this. It is important that we address our civilian workforce. And as we have talked about our response to COVID-19, we do have a combat mission to continue to make sure that we are continuing to generate and sustain combat ready airmen to do what the nation needs us to do. That requires a whole group of folks that work on the base, and our message has been that every member of our wings, whether you wear the uniform or you come to work in civilian attire, is an important part of generating that combat mission. I understand there's a lot of angst right now about the folks that you've been asking to come to work. We hope to address some of those concerns today, but I would just like to say that we do view that as an essential mission activity to include a lot of those services that you wouldn't think about directly contributing to the mission. Those services that support our folks are also an important part of generating combat air power, and a big part of that is our civilian workforce. And we appreciate everyone that is part of that and their continued efforts in order to help us with that. Now, based on the fact I'm not the expert in civilian personnel, and I know you aren't, I'm going to clear stage left and allow Ms. Gracie Harrison to come forward as the expert from the CPO office to address more concerns. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Deadeye. Gracie, would you please join us? And so, as she approaches the stage and the microphone, some of the ROE, or rules of engagement, what we're going to go through is we've received several questions throughout the week since our very first town hall, and we're going to go through those, and I'll kind of follow up with a few questions. And I know, Gracie, I know you had some time to look at the group and review these questions and provide your expert guidance and answers.
Yes.
And so I think for the broader audience, we will try and make sure that we address those questions via this stream. And then also understand, too, that as we go through this town hall, it is recorded, it is live, and that we develop a transcript that is posted to our website. The thing that we would want to make sure is that this is an extremely dynamic environment. And so we make decisions based on that info that we have current and that is in front of us at that time. And then we get guidance that could maybe change it, or environmentals, the climate could change. So it's constantly evolving, but the one thing that we will make sure that we continue to do is continue this dialogue, continue this communication, continue to review all the policies and procedures that we utilize to make sure that we are able to deliver that combat power that Colonel Marshall was talking about. And so with that, I'm going to go through the series of questions that we had received from our Facebook comments section. All right. So with that, the first question that I'm going to ask is, if I'm home under quarantine, how do I categorize this time?
For the purposes of COVID, this time would be categorized as administrative leave or weather and safety. It is the same exact thing, just different times. In the system is administrative leave, and VM titles it weather and safety. If you are sent home from work, that is also happening. So depending on the conditions of the quarantine, whether it was directed by public health, local authorities, and or your unit, it would be administrative.
Okay, and then I think you mentioned it, but it, obviously the squadron commander involvement is a key part of that process.
Absolutely. To the fullest extent possible, individuals, commanders, employees alike should be exploring the option to telework whenever possible if your duties allow. So having that discussion, whether it be by the phone, during quarantine, to establish what can I do from home, with equipment or without equipment. Sometimes you can do analysis, or do your training from home without CAC-enabled, equipment that has CAC-enabled leaders. So things like that that you can be accomplished at home should be. And other than that, if you cannot accomplish all the work, then it would be at home.
Okay. All right. So, and this is the complication about this new dynamic environment. So we're making adjustments on the fly. What I'm going to try and do is I will move the microphone to the person that is speaking so that we can make sure that we're heard on the stream. And I apologize for those listeners and viewers out there on Facebook. We are going to speak as quickly and as loud as necessary to make sure that you hear what we're talking about. So our apologies up front.
Ask the questions again, please.
Okay. All right, so we're gonna reframe and restart because apparently the first question wasn't heard. And let me start with, if I'm home under quarantine, how do I categorize this time?
Thank you. Okay, if you're home under quarantine, whether it's directed by public health, local authorities, and or your unit, it would be considered administrative leave or weather and safety leave, which is the same thing. If there is a possibility for you to telework, commanders and supervisors, first line managers and employees alike should be exploring the possibilities to telework. If that is not a possibility, if all type of work has been exhausted, such as policy reviews, training, administrative duties that you can accomplish from home, then it would be administrative leave.
Okay, perfect. And then the next question says, how do I know if I'm required to come into work as opposed to stay at home?
This applies under any circumstance, COVID or not. Individuals should be checking in with their supervisors. If that first line supervisor is not available, you should check in with their second line, moving up to chain of command. But that clarification should come directly from either your supervisor or somebody in the chain of command.
Perfect. All right, next question is, what if I'm told to report to work because my job is essential, but I don't feel comfortable doing this?
This takes us back to the first question. If you're not comfortable coming to work, you need to have a discussion with your supervisor or somebody in your chain of command to talk about flexibility, such as performing work from home and or maybe altering your shift, coming in at a different time when the rest of the population has left the facility. You should explore all options to be able to accomplish the duties that the mission requires. However, if once you discuss with your supervisor, you still feel that you can't reach an agreement about what type of shift you can do due to childcare limitations or other personal circumstances you might have, personal leave would be the next option to explore with approval from your chain of command.
And then, what if I'm high risk, but I can't complete my job via telework?
So again, all avenues of telework should be reviewed, explored. Sometimes we forget about duties that we can accomplish at home, such as training, or if there's old desk guides that haven't been updated, standard operating procedures, internal operating procedures that you can develop from home. You should think about outside the box, things that you can do from home. At the end of the day, if you can't accomplish that job from home because of the duties that you perform on a daily basis, but you are required to come to work, then you need to discuss with your supervisor the possibility of personal leave. I'm sorry. It said high risk, correct?
Yes.
Yes, okay, I'm sorry. So if you're, I forgot about the high risk piece, sorry everyone. So if you're high risk, and through either CDC direction and or local government, UK standards, if you're high risk and there's no telework, then it's admin leave.
All right, so then if health and well-being is so important, why do some facilities still remain open and require us to work?
So I'll answer the civilian personnel portion of that question. As mission dictates and management dictates, some responsibilities and duties have to be accomplished accomplished in order to support the local airmen and their families, as well as those essential civilians performing the work. So support staff sometimes is required to come in to help maintain those critical services that are required on base.
Yeah, and I can't stress that enough, and I think if you were able to hear Colonel Marshall in his opening comments and statements, we do have a very critical mission here that enables combat power. Every individual that is a part of the base infrastructure and personnel are critical to that mission. And so on a day-to-day basis, we need you. Certainly during a time of crisis, we need you probably even more. And so some of the things that we really try to enforce is the fact that every individual is extremely valuable to us. We value your health and well-being, and we take every precaution necessary to ensure that you're safe. And so it is really important when we determine that we need you, we've thought through all that, and we need you to understand that we've thought through how important it is to have your services available to help support the mission. So the next question. I'm okay with coming into work, but I'm not busy the entire time. What can be done about this?
So this is, again, a discussion that you should have with your chain of command. All work possibilities during this time should be exhausted. If you are running out of duties, you need to talk to your chain of command. There are things, again, that we can get creative with as far as those responsibilities that maybe, you know, filing, things like that, depending on your work center. But you should definitely consult with your management before you make the determination as an employee that you have no work, as there are certain duties that can be found for you to help with while you're still here. If for whatever reason the unit decides that for the day work has ended and they decide to send you home, then it would be administrative leave. If you choose to leave early, you through supervisory approval, you would use your personal leave.
Yeah, I would also add that, you know, we are in a dynamic environment. We've adjusted a lot of things across the enterprise, and that is all of the operations across the entire globe at military bases. And what we found is that by providing the social distancing and creating shifts, creating teams, altering schedules, and sometimes the people that you normally would converse with, work with, interact with, aren't there because they're doing telework or they're doing other activities. And what we found for uniform members is sometimes we may ask them to do something that is not normally part of their normal day-to-day job in a normal environment. For instance, we have sought out volunteers to help stock shelves in the commissary, and it's a voluntary option for them. And why is that? It's to help our community out, because we cannot keep up with the current demand that is taxing some of our commissaries. And so there are going to be times where it may appear to you that you're not busy, but in the grand scheme of things, after things level out, I think we'll find that there's going to be a way to help manage that workload more effectively and more efficiently. We're in that initial stage of this crisis, and we want to get further along, and as we do this, there will be some lulls, but we hope to minimize those as much as possible. Your communication, your feedback is very valued and extremely helpful. All right, so for the next question. What is my pay status if my supervisor sends me home when I'm done with my work?
So that question is a little tricky. So when you're done with your work, it can mean you're done with responsibilities during your shift, or it could also mean I'm done with my shift. So if at the end of the shift you're asked to go home, then you just go home as normal. If you are done with your duties before the end of your shift, or your regular duty hours, and your supervisor asks you to leave the premises, then it would be either taking some work home, telework, or you would be on administrative leave.
All right, so then the next question is, if the UK government is saying I should only report to work if absolutely necessary, why am I being told to come into work?
Thank you. mission dependent and unit dependent, depending on whatever unique support that unit is providing. As Colonel Marshall mentioned earlier, some responsibilities, duties need to be accomplished in order to provide support to the airmen that remain performing those critical functions. So we are, although we're minimizing the amount of individuals that, that have to come in, some duties and responsibilities are required, essential to the mission, and that is why some individuals are being asked to still continue to report to work.
Yeah, we sometimes categorize these things as a second or third order effect, and if an individual that doesn't think that their position or the activities that they do are critical to that mission, they're probably might be mistaken, because oftentimes it might not be directly supporting, but it might be supporting somebody that is directly supporting the mission. And so we find, though, that it's really important to have that discussion with your leadership, and we will work with you to make sure that we address your concerns. So before I get into the next question, I think it's very important to mention this. We've got different categories of civilians out there, and I wanted to make sure that we address all of them. And I talked a little bit earlier, and it might not have been heard, so I want to make sure that we're kind of responding to the GS employees, the NAF employees, the LNDH, and then MOD. Important to that piece is the MOD element in support of what we do. And so we are talking to the United Kingdom, and with the Ministry of Defense staff, we need to make sure that we are available to answer your questions. And some of those we're not going to be able to answer today. And so we did some liaison with Group Captain Sean Harris, and unfortunately he couldn't attend here because of another military obligation. So he wanted to provide the audience that has direct questions on MOD with this following statement. So if you don't mind, I'm going to go ahead and read that first. So, for MOD colleagues, I apologize that I cannot be there at the town hall today to help answer MOD-specific questions that I know some of you have. We have been working hard to get the latest MOD information to you via local business support teams, but I recognize there may have been some frustrating communications problems during this challenging period. In case you have not heard, or excuse me, in case you have not had access to MOD information, or you have other more specific questions, I'll be conducting 3 one-hour dial-in question and answer sessions tomorrow, specifically for MOD staff. One for those at Milton Hall, one for Lake and Haith base personnel, and the final one for other U.S. visiting forces bases. Timings and details of how to dial into these meetings can be obtained by emailing Mr. Mark Young at mark.young575@mod.gov.uk. I'll repeat that. mark.young575@mod.gov.uk as soon as possible. We and our United States Air Force colleagues are committed to only having those people physically in work who are absolutely necessary, in the smallest numbers, and nobody from vulnerable groups. We also have a shared commitment to ensuring, in accordance with the United Kingdom government direction, that hand washing and social distancing in the workplace are rigidly adhered to. However, we also need you to take personal responsibility for ensuring that you and others stick to the rules. These are truly unprecedented times where, for example, cleaners who are not needed on snow days have become key workers and vital to keeping operations staff safe. Do not underestimate the important role that you all play every day in the United Kingdom's defense through the NATO alliance, keeping you, your friends, and your family safe 24/7 is a primary job. The COVID-19 pandemic is the greatest challenge of modern times that I know, and I know that you, whatever your specific job as part of the Ministry of Defense team, can be relied upon to play your part. And he looks forward to talking to you tomorrow during one of his MOD U.S. Visiting Forces staff dial-in sessions. And that was from Group Captain Sean Harris. And so with that in mind, I'm going to go with the next. next question. If I'm told by my supervisor not to come into work, but I can't telework, what status does this put me in?
So I can't stress this enough. Telework should be explored to the fullest extent possible, both by employees and management. If there are duties that you can perform from work, with or without government equipment, it is permissible and should be explored. However, if there is no work that you can perform from home and your supervisor asks you to leave the facility or your work site, go home, that is administrative leave.
Okay, and then what if I'm not feeling well and need to stay home, completely unrelated to COVID-19?
That is a normal sick leave that you would use, depending on your circumstances. If you don't have sick leave, there is the opportunity for to request advanced sick leave, annual leave, or leave without pay.
All right, can I still take leave during this time?
Yes, absolutely. With supervisory approval, we are all able to request whatever category of leave is on your books. That includes advanced leave, advanced annual leave, and leave without pay. However, we must remember that if we are requesting personal leave, we still have to adhere to the UK limitations as far as movement restrictions and adhere to the installation commander's movement restrictions.
Perfect. All right, so we had a few questions from our previous town hall that we're going to help provide some of those answers right now. Let's see here. I heard an employee at the Lake and Heath BX tested positive and they refused to close, putting all other employees at risk. Is this true? Oh, maybe public. Okay, all right. Well, I can tell you based on on the information I have right now, public health interviews all people with a positive COVID-19 test. And then determines through their activities if there were any personal interactions to make sure that they identify people that could be at risk as well. As of the 25th of March, so yesterday, there have been no high-risk interactions for either employees or patrons at both RAF Lake and Heath and RAF Millenhall BX. So the answer to that one would be untrue. Okay. So part of the other thing that I wanted to make sure I addressed is I think we've seen some questions on contractors and how we are working with contractors. So the contracting squadron that is at the 48th Fighter Wing, they are in direct engagement and involvement with all the contracts that are currently let, and they are directly talking to all of their supervision to determine what can be done and what can continue. And so what I recommend for those contractors is please talk to your leadership within your contracting element. They are directly talking to our contracting squadron. As of right now, primary F-35 contracting operations are continuing and are definitely key and essential. All right, so I'm going to what we've received via our chats on Facebook. And so bear with me as I go through a number of questions that we've received. So let's see here. So question number one. Okay, can you define what is deemed as essential to mission? And I think we've touched on that from both yourself, Gracie. I know Colonel Marshall had mentioned it, but let me reiterate to you. What we are working through right now is unprecedented in nature and unprecedented in time. We must continue to pursue our global mission, projecting combat power, and to that end, what we ask is, and what we've given our squadron commanders is that authority and review of what they deem as essential to making sure that their mission can continue. And to that, I would say that if a squadron commander has determined that they need a certain task to be performed and an individual is involved with that task, then yes, it is essential to the mission. And so I think we mentioned it before, there are second and third order effects, and we're all interconnected in various ways. And so absences do affect the mission in varying ways. When it directly impacts the mission, then we have reason to be concerned. And so you might not think that your current role and responsibility is essential, but I would tell you that as the squadron commanders review the task that they need to accomplish, they're making that determination, and they're making sure that if they bring you in, that your safety is paramount. And so when they ask, that is one of the things that I would ask you to consider. Okay, so the UK government has been sending people on vulnerable lists to stay at home for 12 weeks. As a UK citizen and spouse, am I to ask my old doctor for a letter, or am I expected to get something from my base PCM to provide to management?
That's not a question.
No, it's okay. All right, so we may have to come back to that. We will review that question for and provide an answer once we talk to a subject matter expert on that. But I believe that we're going to have to refer that to our medical team and then determine through the UK side of the house and get a legal reading on that. So how about this one? Let's see. What happens if your leadership is classing you as mission critical and is not in your PD and you have not had prior notification?
So as Colonel Panhandle has mentioned, this is an unprecedented event. And due to having no historical experience with an event of this type in recent history, some positions that were previously not classified as mission essential have been determined to be mission essential or essential to the mission. I think it's important for both employees and supervisors to understand their roles and responsibilities at this time. Frank discussions and frequent discussions should be occurring between supervisors and managers so that both have an agreement and understanding on what is mission, what is essential about your position. If that has not been clarified to you, you are entitled to understand why your position is essential. You should follow up with management. If your first level supervisor is unable to answer your questions, you need to elevate that. Employees are entitled to full understanding of why the position is essential. However, management makes the decisions on why a position is essential.
Okay, and then if placed on admin pay, is it full pay or reduced?
It is just as if you were at work. It's your regular pay.
Okay, and then let's see. I'm an LNDH that works at the post office. I am well, feel fine, but should be home self-isolating or continue to work. If I am to self-isolate, will I still be paid? Is there any form of paperwork that needs to be completed, and when would I be returning to work?
So an employee who chooses to self-isolate, just based out of precaution, not for any high-risk reason or because they've been exposed, that would be your own personal leave with the approval of your management. The period of leave is dependent between your request and whatever management approves. If you are granted admin leave for reasons of exposure, because you've been asked to leave the work site, or because you are considered high risk, or because you have a family member who is ill with COVID, the period of admin leave is typically in line with the government and CDC recommendations of 14 days at this point. 14 days start from the day that you were exposed. So we count that way. From the day you were exposed, if you've been at work 2 days, those 2 days count, and then we credit the remainder through admin leave. The end of the admin leave period would either be at the 14 days, or depending on if you're teleworking, you wouldn't be on admin leave, or when you're asked to return to work at some point after those 14 days. Supervisor should be assessing at the 14-day point.
So I got two questions that I'm going to kind of combine together because I think they're very related. So the first part of that, it says, are contractors considered essential to the mission? And for example, there is a contractor who says, I'm a cleaner working on base, and our government says, only key workers go into work. How does the base classify us as a key worker?
So again, that's a management decision, and it's based on individual unit requirements, on the unit's mission, whatever they need to accomplish. So as Colonel Pananon mentioned, each squadron commander has been delegated the authority to make those decisions, evaluate positions as needed. So the key designation or essential designation would come from at the discretion of each individual commander based on whatever that organization is performing and supporting.
Is there anything in place for essential workers with high risk dependents?
Yes. Again, to the fullest extent possible, management and employees should be exploring the availability of telework so that you can stay at home with your high risk dependents if they require care from you. For example, minor dependents, or even elderly dependents. At this time, if your dependent is not sick but high risk, telework to the maximum extent possible. However, if you choose to stay home with an asymptomatic dependent, that is personal leave. If your dependent becomes ill with COVID, then administrative leave may be approved if your unit and or public health official or local authorities direct you to stay home.
Okay, how is the CDC staff considered essential when there are no children to be supervised?
So again, that's an individual commander decision. My opinion from civilian personnel would be that that type of position is key in order to support the airmen performing these mission essential duties.
And I can't stress that enough. Sometimes we fail to recognize how important our positions are. And so what we've asked in our particular instance at Mildenhall is we did ask the CDC staff to come in and ensure that our CDC was clean and safe in preparation for when we needed it to restart an operation, whether it be limited, scaled, or full operation. Because in these times, because we have a mission that many, many people depend on outside of this country and in this country, it is important that we support those members that require maybe some help to watch their children during these times. And so the squadron commanders have a lot of responsibility, and they make that determination that they need that particular airman or civilian member to come in, and then that member requires the CDC to help support them. Then we need to have that CDC open, and we need to have staff members come in to help support that effort. And so again, this is a dynamic and rapidly changing environment. And right now we're currently focused in on COVID-19, but we don't know what other things could occur and what else we might need to support. And so we just gotta keep that in mind. All right, next question is, who determines if you are essential to a mission? To mission. And I probably could take that. I think we've said it multiple times. It's the commanders. They've been given a lot of responsibility. They know the mission well, they know their people well, they know what they need, and so they'll make that determination. All right, how about, are you going to provide letters to stop LNDH getting fined by local police? I think I'll answer that, and I know you have a lot of these answers yourself, but yes, we have in development a letter that you can provide to constabulary if you were to be stopped for any reason. We are definitely focusing in on our civilian populace that may get stopped during these times of the restrictions that have been put in place. I know that the 48th Fighter Wing has developed their letter. They're getting that out as quickly as possible, and we're following suit, so we're not far behind. But yes, we are working that right now. The other part of this is that we have a great relationship with the constabularies in the local area. And so we've already informed them and socialized them that there will be instances where we need individuals that are essential to the mission to come in. So they're aware that if an individual is coming to support our mission at either of the bases, or any of the U.S. visiting forces, that they have a current understanding that they should let those individuals come and proceed. But we are following up, and we're taking good measure to have a letter in place that allows for those constabularies to let you proceed. Okay. Let's see here. On your last town hall, you said LMDH should stay home. Okay. So I'm not sure if I heard that, or I'm sorry, I'm not sure if I vocalized that when we were before the microphone set up, and now that we are here at this point. I will tell you that this is an extremely dynamic environment. We continue to make decisions based on the information that we have at that point in time. But the conditions always change, and we get new information, we get new guidance, we get new policies. And so that decision that we made yesterday could change, and it could be absolutely opposite or 180 degrees out from the decision that we made 2 days ago. So I will tell you that we are going to continue to evaluate every decision that we make to keep up with the constant change. The only thing that I can tell you to help reassure you is that our communication is going to be constant and vigilant. We're going to make sure that we inform you of any of those changes, specifically changes in decisions that we make. All right, let's see. There are shops in civil engineering that could be ran by the military personnel, running on emergency work orders only until this passes. Why are the British, who are under instructions from their government to stay at home unless they are essential staff, required to still come in and possibly take this virus home to our families, some of which are key workers and working flat out in health service? Okay, me. All right. So I will tell you that there is no definitive timeline on how long this pandemic could endure. And so I will say that every individual that we have, that we ask, and we've determined that we need to come in and support the mission is required. We balance all that out, we make a risk assessment, and then we determine who we need to come in. And so if you're being asked by your commander to come in, then we encourage you to do just that. Have that conversation. If you have an extenuating circumstance, have that conversation with your leadership, and we'll see about how we can go forward. But really, truly, trust us when we say this. We are determining what we need and consider to be essential. All right. Does admin leave get paid? I think we've covered that.
Yes. Admin leave is simply a status that allows you to receive pay without charge to your personal leave categories or balances. So this is a category that basically is as if you were home, but it records that you were authorized to be away from the work site with pay without charge to your leave balances. That concludes the end of that question, but I would like to go back to one where an individual asked what type of paperwork was required, and I forgot to answer that. At this time, there is no documentation requirement. That may change as we get additional guidance from either DOD, Air Force, and over the local government. But at this time, we are relying and trusting on the workforce to be honest with their chain of command, and for the chain of command to make decisions based on whatever is essential to their missions.
And I think you were just addressing the fact that did they need to get a sort of documentation from their medical provider, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. Can our supervisors make the determination of who stays home and who doesn't, or so we have to wait for guidance from further up the chain, GS specifically?
At this time, those decisions are delegated to squadron commanders. First line supervisors, second line supervisors may make recommendations to the squadron commanders, and with their approval, concurrence, those decisions will come down. But for frontline supervisors, are not authorized that at this time.
Yeah, and then I can concur with that. Specific to that guidance, we really have placed a lot of responsibility on the squadron commanders, but they do take advice and they do take recommendations from the leadership levels at each echelon. So constant communication and discussions with your leadership is critical to this time. All right, will there be a policy letter addressing different employee statuses, which pertains to, okay, I got it. So I'll tell you right now what we were working through. As I may have mentioned earlier, we have approximately five different kind of categories here that help support our missions in this area. And so with that in mind, trying to craft a policy letter that addresses each category is a bit challenging, but we're working through it. We think we've made some progress in certain categories, and we're still working through some of the other ones. Please, your patience is really critical to this. We are working through this. We're trying to make sure that we address the most widespread concerns that and policy that captures all of the audience. But in certain conditions, there are going to be individuals that we may have to work on a extenuating circumstance or work individually. And so it's important to stay latched up with your command, your leadership, and of course your human resources operations. Let's see. Why are lodging, front desk, NAV, non-appropriated funds, civilian employees, mission critical? We meet the most individuals as we are open 24/7. What is being done to pre-order us? Air crews in from the U.S. can still be carrying the virus, and we are in the firing zone when checking them in. We can't do this work from home. I think I can address that myself. Again, the thing that we have to ensure that everyone knows is that during this time in this situation, the operations that we are required to execute can be varying. And the air crew members that are sometimes transiting our bases are moving forward to conduct combat operations, support combat operations, support humanitarian operations, or medical evacuation. Their missions are very critical to ensuring the safety of not just those here, but those abroad. And so I would tell you that the cleanliness and sanitation of our lodging facilities is a high priority. We must have clean workspaces, clean lodging, and clean environments for members that are transiting both in and out. The things that I will tell you that we can, that I can assure you of, is as members transit this base, our transient alert personnel, in conjunction with public health, do a test to ensure that members that are transiting do not exhibit any signs of a virus or carrying a virus or are ill. And so they come here both pre-departure and as they arrive safe and free from instances where we might be concerned. Again, your safety is paramount. The safety of others is paramount. And what we need from you is just understanding that we are trying to protect everybody in this situation. And we must have facilities that can support this mission. Okay, another tie to that is housekeeping mission essential. I think we've said this. It is definitely essential to every mission set that we see at this base, and that is conducted out of Lake and Heath and the surrounding U.S. Visiting Forces bases. We absolutely have to have clean and sanitary lodging for our members and the people that are executing the mission. So we thank you for your understanding, we thank you for your support, and please know that you are absolutely essential. Can Ellen D.H. telework?
Yes, absolutely. For the period of COVID, USAFE issued a telework policy that allows individuals to telework from alternate locations, such as their home. And it includes the ability to telework while you're taking care of a dependent, which is not something that is regular, and we really appreciate that, being able to telework while you're taking care of a dependent. So long as you meet the requirements of your tour of duty, that you can take full advantage of telework when your duties allow.
Okay, this is a good one. How long can you be on admin leave for?
So long as the squadron commander authorizes it and as needed. So it really is dependent case by case, but there is no limitation. There's no minimum and there's no maximum. It will be determined on a case by case basis.
Okay, and what if you are considered high risk and essential to the mission?
So high risk and essential to the mission, you maximize the utilization of telework, but absolutely we're taking into consideration the fact that you are high risk. So if you are unable to telework, you're essential, the discussion with the supervisor should occur, and you may be entitled to administrative leave if you are high risk. Health is priority.
All right, let's see, what happens with people who could otherwise go to work but now have no child care available? Do you want me to?
Sure.
Okay, I think that kind of goes back to the point where we discussed the value of the Child Development Center. There is gonna be a time, and again, we don't know when it will occur, but there will be likely a time where we need to depend on individuals that come in that are essential to the mission. They may be uniform wearing, they may be a civilian status, regardless, they may require child care. And so in those instances, that Child Development Center is gonna be a critical part of helping us execute the mission. And so when I go back to that, when we run into these situations where you are essential to the mission, whether you're uniform or out, we will need you to talk to leadership so that we can put in place some opportunities to address those concerns. And so it may mean opening up the Child Development Center, or it may mean the community helping in and pitching in to ensure that your children are taken care of. There's ways to go about this, but really feedback and communication are important. All right. So again, I'm getting another stream in here, and it's really addressed to the contractors. For the contractors that are out there watching this stream, I'm going to reiterate that the 48th Contracting Squadron at Lake Keneath is reviewing with the leadership each and every contract to determine if essential to the mission, several of which are important to execute our mutually beneficial missions with our UK partners. And so the Contracting Squadron is responsible for not only Lake Keneath, but Millenhall. And so as they review these with the contractors, they're making and working together to ensure that there's a clear understanding of the importance. Let's see here. Is there a plan to reopen the CDCs? If you were to ask me at this moment, at this juncture today, no. But I'm not gonna leave that off the table, and I don't believe Colonel Marshall's gonna leave that off the table. Because again, if it comes down to it, we need a certain individual or groups of individuals to come in, we may need that CDC to reopen, to execute and perform our mission. All right, let's see here. Okay, so from the stream, Rachel Westra asked, how can I help and volunteer? I'll tell you right now, the thing that we appreciate most, we just had an opportunity yesterday where the commissary was having, and maybe if you've been shopping there, you've noted that some of the shelves have been barren, and really it's a function of not that the supplies aren't here, it's that we don't have enough personnel to help stock those shelves. And so we put a call out for volunteers, and sure enough, we did have some volunteers to help stock one of the commissaries. And so what a great opportunity. It's all about building community and helping community, because when those items are available on those shelves, that helps those families get provided with the things that they may need, which could be food or other items. So what I would say is that if you're considering volunteering and you feel that you have an opportunity to share, you can share that on our comments section, and we're trying to coordinate all of our volunteer efforts. We do have a number of teams that are working to kind of organize that, and so please stand by. We'll make sure that we have something in place that allows you to volunteer for those efforts. Let's see here. All right, so any questions that are related to medical, just understand that we will review all the questions that are in the stream, and if they're medical related, we will table those for now, but you will get answered. I want to assure you of that. And that also goes to when we run short on time here. We've got about 10 more minutes, but when we run short on time, please continue to feed those questions into the stream. We will answer those questions, and if they need to be answered directly to you, we will direct message you, or if it benefits the entire audience, we will provide an answer in the transcripts or in the comments section. So we've found that this is a very useful way and a resource to share with the audience that's out there. All right, so how about this question? How does this affect new hires that are supposed to start within the next month? If our office is currently teleworking, how do we get the new hire started, trained, or will their start date be postponed?
The answer will be a little bit different depending on the category of individual that is reporting. So for GS individuals, we are still affecting their start date so long as they're still available to start, but they immediately go. Well, we discuss with the supervisor first, but more than likely, if they're not essential, they will immediately go into a status of administrative leave until the supervisor can determine, or the squadron commander can determine, what type of work can be assigned to them. For LNDH, something similar. It will be, if you have a start date already established, we will go ahead and start, but the individual will not actually report. They will be placed on administrative leave until it can be determined whether telework can be somehow arranged or until operations resume to closer to normalcy.
Great. Gracie, I think this is more of a generic question and statement also. So with your responsibility, we've been dealing directly, most of these questions have been coming from Millenhall and Lakeneath, but you do have a greater responsibility, is that correct?
That is correct. We service all USAFE assets across the UK and Norway.
And so some of the questions that have been coming in and some of the answers we provided, please, I reiterate to continue to work with your leadership. We do have a responsibility for those areas of members that are here in the UK and Norway. But work through your leadership, and then our civilian personnel office will try to address those and work in coordination with the local wing leadership to make sure that we respond to your concerns. Do mission essentials get hazard pay?
No, sir. Not at this time. Mission essential is a category that addresses functions that are essential to the mission. Hazard pay addresses conditions in which you would be exposed to, for example, fire or things like that, working combat, right? But that could, again, change based on the fact that, you know, this is ever evolving, and that would be determined not at a later date.
It says here, can you define situational telework? Can I use my personal computer to complete appropriate work? Not FOUO and not PII.
Situational telework is a category in which telework is not regular and recurring, or not 100% telework. It is based on situation, and you can be on situational telework when you will not be performing telework 100% of the time throughout your employment. So situational is, the word itself is based on situations.
That's fair. All right, as we minimize personnel at work to essential mission, can admin leave and alternate work schedules to reduce workforce, but still preserve mission capability. Work, i.e., work 1 week, admin leave next week.
That would be squadron dependent. It just depends on whatever the unit is performing. So, for example, if there are a lot of individuals working in a closed space, that could be a possibility. But there's also shift work, so it doesn't necessarily have to be just admin leave. You can split your shifts up into different hours.
And again, every unit, at least at for sure at Lincoln Heath and at Millenhall, we all have unique mission sets, and we all have unique circumstances. And so I reiterate, as your commanders are working through this and discussing options with the second and third and every echelon of supervision, they will determine what is the best way to employ their force. And so in doing so, they'll make sure that they coordinate with the HR office to get advice, and then from there on out, they will work through that. So Larry Johnson, shout out to you. Is there an opportunity for us to help monetarily? Who want to send food, etc.? Opportunity to reiterate, we are a family across all work sessions. This is a team effort, and I applaud you, sir. I think it's incumbent upon us to help find a way to kind of organize that activity. And so we'll reach out directly, but we'll also advertise how we can affect that and how we can help us, help everybody out, help this community out. One thing that we're doing here at Millenhall is we do have a food pantry where members can donate food and like goods to include cleaning supplies. All those donations are accessible by our first sergeants, and they're entirely free. And so that is an opportunity that's available at Millenhall. But we will seek to make sure that we have a way to share that effort across the bases and to the families that are affected. Let's see here. If you are on admin leave, how do you put your time in ATAPS?
That is...
And we'll follow back up with that code in the answer and transcripts. It says, I'm on admin leave at the moment, but return next week. How can I ensure social distancing is being followed? Okay. Yeah, and so I can assure you that every unit, every organization across both bases is very well aware of social distancing. And so, we will ensure that those practices are followed. It is certainly personal responsibility, but in cases where your work center does not make that possible, then we will try to ensure that we provide a way to ensure that we can follow that guidance. Let's see here. We're running up to near the end. I'm going to close it off with this one last question. Where can I review and see latest guidance on civilian personnel matters?
So it will depend on your category of LNDH, GS, MOD, or NAF. Each category has my purse has a page for each category. OPM has a page. MOD, you go through your BST. There, OPM, my purse. MOD, BST, and I think that's NAF has their own page. I'm sorry, I forgot. Again, you can find that through MyPers, and the Office of Management and Budget also has a page.
Okay, and I'll try to help the effort also, at least if we can. We have a link on our homepage, millenhall.af.millen. I know that Lincoln Heath does as well. And it's a COVID-19 link, and then maybe we can kind of put links that will help point to some of those resources. And so our team will look at that to make those updates as we come along. All right, so unfortunately, we're coming close to the ending of our scheduled town hall time here. I just want to close with something real quick, and I just want to reiterate to each one of you out there, all of our civilian populace, you are absolutely critical to the mission. Each of our civilian members, you on a day-to-day basis, help us execute a really vital mission. Certainly in this time of this kind of crises, we look to you to assist us in making sure that we're able to do exactly what our nations require of us. So just want to say thank you for everything that you do. Please be patient with us, stay safe, and we're going to be continuing this communication and this dialogue. Thank you, Gracie, for your assistance today. Thank you, Colonel Marshall, and we will be in touch, and we're signing off.